Hello everyone. So guys, do you know that India has become the first country in Asia to have a plastic pact? What is it? What is the implication of signing a plastic pact? That we will be discussing in this video. But apart from that, we will also be discussing about the World Social Protection report that has been released by International Labour Organization. Apart from this, the World University rankings have also been released. So all of this, in addition to some other questions, are there in this video. So your responsibility is to watch this video till the end of it. Okay. But before beginning the questions, I would like to tell you guys that you can subscribe our channel and hit the bell notification. And also you can join this Telegram group where you will get the free PDF of our session. So here is the very first question, which is about the report of ILO, International Labour Organization. So guys, before reading out the question or before moving on to the report itself, I would like to ask you a question about the International Labour Organization. So actually there are two questions that you have to answer. One is the headquarter of the ILO and the year in which the ILO was established. So these are the two questions I have put out for you that you have to mention in the comment section below. Now let's move on to this question. What is the percentage of the global population which is still not covered under any social security benefit as per the World Social Protection Report 2020 to 2022 of ILO? So as per this report, in the world right now we have 53.1% of the total global population. I hope that you are understanding the impact of it. Out of the total global population, 53.1% of the people are not covered even under any one social security benefit. Social security benefit comprise of your pension or other kinds of benefits, education and some, not education particularly, insurance. Okay, so these are some of the social security benefits that have been assessed in this report. So right now 53.1% of the global population is deprived of any social security benefit. So apart from this, there are other facts as well in this report. So let's have a look at those facts. So guys, the very first thing is the title of this report. I think this is not very important, but just you need to have a look at the complete title of this report. So Social Protection at the Crossroad in Pursuit of a Better Future. So this means this report is highlighting the high point that has come, that now the governments across the world need to take a call and increase the social protection coverage of its population. Okay, as of 2020, 53.1% of the global population or 4.1 billion people were not covered under any social security scheme. The remaining 46.9% of the global population was covered under at least one social security scheme. So they are not saying that the remaining percentage of the population is covered under various social security schemes. However, they are not completely deprived of being covered under the social security benefits. They are covered at least under one social security benefit. And majorly, for example, if you take the example of India, then you have health insurance, life insurance. So these are the social security schemes. So majority of the people, not the majority, but the urban areas, in urban areas, we can say the majority of the people at least own one social security benefit in India. I'm particularly talking about India. Okay, the next point says that globally, the countries are spending 12.9% of their GDPs on an average basis on social security schemes, excluding health. So this 12.9% excludes health. Health pe alag se kharcha kiya jata hai. This is particularly for the other social security benefits. For example, India also spends a lot on pension schemes. Okay, so pension is one of the social security benefit. Next comes, high income countries are spending at least 16.4% of their GDP on social security, whereas low income countries are spending only 1.1% of their GDP on social security benefits. So from here, this difference is stemming, the 53.1% of population, because high income countries or upper middle income countries are already providing the social security benefits to their population, but the difference comes from the low income countries. Okay, so they are spending as low as 1.1% of their GDP on covering their population under the social security benefit schemes. Now here, region wise, 84% of the population approximately in Europe and Central Asia are covered under at least one social security benefit, whereas in Africa, 17.4% of the population is under social security benefit. And here we are talking about the entire continent of Africa. Now this picture shows the various segments of the population who are taking the social security benefits or who are covered under any of the social benefit schemes. For example, children, the total percentage of children out of the total child population in the world, 26.4% of the total child population in the world are covered under the social protection coverage. Mothers with newborns, 44.9%. So if we calculate the total population of the world in terms of mothers who have given birth to newborns, then out of that total proportion, 44.9% are covered under one or the other social benefit schemes. Person with severe disability, 33.5% people across the world are covered. And remember that we are talking about the persons with disability. So this 33.5% is out of the total population of PWD across the world. Workers in case of work injury, so 35.4% are covered. Unemployed workers, only 18.6% are covered. Older persons, so highest is there, 77.5%. So out of the total old population of the world, 77.5% people are covered under the social security benefit schemes. For example, the pensions for the older people. Vulnerable person covered by social assistance, so 28.9% of such vulnerable people are covered under the social security benefit. So guys, this is basically for your conceptual understanding. It has nothing to do with your phase 1 GA examination. This is the suggestion that this report has put forward for the governments, for the researchers in general or policy makers. Okay, so this report is saying that many countries have arrived at a crossroad and now they have to choose either of these roads in order to move ahead and increase the outreach of social security benefits. So if you want to read them out, then you can just read them, but they are nothing, just the suggestions given by this report. Now comes our next question. Recently, the Times Higher Education has released its World University Rankings 2022, which assesses more than 1600 universities across 99 countries and territories based on certain parameters. A total of 13 indicators are used to determine the rankings of universities. These 13 parameters or indicators are divided into four domains, which are teaching, research, knowledge transfer, and international outlook. This year's ranking has been topped by University of Oxford, followed by California Institute of Technology and Harvard University at the second position. How many Indian universities have featured among the top 500 universities of this ranking? So this question is there. You have 4, 5, 7, 10, 9. Out of all of these options, the right answer is option A. A total number of 4 Indian universities have featured among the top 500 universities of the world. And guys, the ranking is not very good. The very first university that has performed well is IISc Bangalore, which is in the group of 301 to 350. Next comes IIT Roper and Mysore-based JSS Academy of Higher Education and Research, which is in the ranking group of 351 to 400. And then come IIT Indore, which is in the grouping of 400 to 500, 401. to 500. So these are the four universities which come under the top 500 rankings of universities in the world. Apart from this, all the information related to this World University Ranking has been provided in the question itself. For example, the organization that has released it is the Higher Education. The number of universities is more than 1600. This is not important for you to memorize, because in your RBS Evi Nabard examination, the max number, the maximum question that can be put from this ranking is these institutions, or the number of total Indian institutions featuring in this ranking, or the top institution. So the top institution is University of Oxford and California Institute of Technology and Harvard University are both tying at the second position. Okay, so apart from this, nothing is there, but do remember the parameters. 13 indicators are there, divided into four domains, which are teaching, research, knowledge transfer, and international outlook. Okay. Now comes the next question. Which country is providing support to India's plastic pact? Before answering this question, let me tell you that India has become the first country in entire Asia to sign a plastic pact. Now, what is the implication, or what is the what are the provisions of this plastic pact, that we will be discussing, of course. But let's first have a look at the answer of this question. So we have UK, Netherlands, Denmark, Finland, Poland in the options, out of which UK is the right answer. So UK is providing assistance to India in implementing its plastic pact. Now, what is the plastic pact? Before moving on to the next slide that describes the plastic pact in detail, I would like to give a brief introduction of this plastic pact. So basically, pact is an agreement. So this agreement is to tackle the plastic waste in India. Okay, so by the channel of this agreement, the government of India will enter into the plastic pact with private companies so that they can reduce the plastic, the usage of plastic in their packaging. Okay, and by using that method in a time-bound manner, so by reducing the usage of plastic in packaging in a time-bound manner, will definitely reduce the plastic waste in India. So that is the whole purpose behind signing this plastic pact or developing this plastic pact. Now, there are certain targets that have been set out in this plastic pact. There are certain organizations that have partnered for this plastic pact. So now let's have a look at those. This I have already told you, and this is in support of UK. So the organization is WWF India and Confederation of Indian Industry. And remember, this plastic pact was adopted at the 16th CII Sustainability Summit. This pact is supported by UK Research and Innovation and Waste and Resources Action Program, which is a charity organization based in UK, and it is endorsed by British High Commission in India. So these are the names of the organizations that are supporting this plastic pact. And I have already told you the aim. The plastic pact aims to reduce the plastic waste in the supply chains by reducing the plastic packaging. The pact will ensure that private entities adhere to the India's plastic pact's target in a time-bound manner. So this is the crux of this pact. Now, these are the targets, which are very important. If you want to have a screenshot of this, then you can have it. Otherwise, I will be providing you the PDF, so you don't have to put an effort in just memorizing it here. You can just understand it here and memorize it better with the PDF. Okay, so these are the targets that have to be achieved by the year 2030. The first target is: define a list of unnecessary or problematic plastic packaging and items and take measures to address them through design and innovation. 100% of plastic packaging to be reusable or recyclable. 50% of plastic packaging to be effectively recycled. 25% of average recycled content across all plastic packaging. So these are the different targets. First target is saying that you have to design your product in such a manner, or your branding in such a manner, that it becomes environmentally friendly and anti-plastic friendly. Okay. Next is 100% of the plastic packaging needs to be reusable and recyclable. Majority of the plastic used in the FMCG goods, fast moving consumer goods, are non-recyclable. And in order to reduce that burden, this target has been put in the plastic pack. Next is 50% of the plastic packaging to be effectively recycled by 2030. So by 2030, whatever the plastic packaging is being done, 50% of that should be recycled effectively. And fourth target is 25% of the average recycled content across all plastic packaging. The meaning of this point or this target is that whatever you are packaging, okay, whatever your good is, the out of that packaging material, 25% of the material should be the recycled material. Okay, so here it is saying that 100% material should be recyclable. Then out of that 100%, next target is saying 50% should be effectively recycled, and 25% of the recycled plastic should be used again in the packaging of the product. So these are the targets. Targets are important, guys. Do memorize the targets. And this point is the general point. You don't have to memorize it. 27 businesses and supporting organizations have joined this pact as the founding members. Okay, so you can memorize this number only. Next is India generates 9.46 megatons of plastic waste annually, out of which 40% is not collected. And about 50% of the all plastic produced in the country are used in packaging, most of which is single use in nature, that you cannot recycle that plastic. Okay, so that is the reality, and these are the targets in order to overturn that reality. I hope that you can understand it well. Now I am moving on to the next question. Recently, Indian Army has signed a contract worth rupees 100 crores for the procurement of 100 explosive-laden suicide drones, which will be manufactured in India by a joint venture between an Indian and Israeli company. What is the name of the Israeli company involved in the manufacturing of suicide drones for the Indian Army? So you have these options: Israel Aerospace Industries, Elbit Security System, Rafael Advanced Defense Systems, IMI Systems, Empressed Systems. So out of these options, the right answer is Elbit Security Systems. From India, Alpha Design is the partner of this organization in this joint venture. And this organization owns, Alpha Design owns 51% of this joint venture. Now, this organization is based in Bangalore, and this manufacturing will also take place in Bangalore. So that was another basic information related to this suicide drone. Now guys, this is not the first time that such kinds of drones are being manufactured or procured in India. Okay, so that was the one thing that you need to keep in mind. This is not the first time, but yes, suicide drones are important because they are in the news and the name is very unique. So I hope that you are excited to know what kind of drones are these suicide drones. So basically, they are nothing. They are just the drones that are automatically, what we can say, that are very sufficient in exploding the target. So once they are shot, then they just go into that target area and explode. So that is the basic functionality of this suicide drone. Okay. Apart from this, don't go into too much detail of this suicide drone. Okay. Who has been appointed as the MD of Solar Energy Corporation of India? So the MD of this organization is Suman Sharma. So she has been appointed recently. So guys, that's all for today's video. I hope that you have enjoyed the video. Thank you so much for watching it.